And the outline is already on the platform. Essential ingredients for success. You can download the outline on the chat. Essential ingredients for success. Achieving success may not be easy, but it is not impossible. That it is not easy does not mean it's impossible. That it is difficult does not mean it cannot be done. It may just require more effort, more passion, more purpose, more focus, but it's achievable. Going about it the right way makes the journey more pleasant and the outcome more predictable. That's the way. If you go about achieving success the right way, you enjoy the process, you enjoy the journey more, and the outcome is more predictable. Very, very important. No matter the field of human endeavor that we are involved in, the basis and the essential ingredients of success, they remain the same. Somebody is an historian. The principles we are talking about tonight is what will help him to be a top historian. Somebody is an administrator. The principles we are learning tonight is what will help him to be the best administrator. We are talking about a politician. Very good politicians, the principles we are talking about today, they will use it. Are you an academic, an engineer, a doctor, a lawyer, a psychologist, even an housewife that is going to be very excellent, that's going to be top, that the husband will be saying, I don't know that somebody can be a full-time housewife and just add value to my life like this. These principles of success, they are also the same, even in the Christian life. You want to be a top pastor. You want to be a top, spiritually, to be really, really your best for God. These principles of success, they are. So they work in the physical realm. They work in the spiritual realm. They work in the social realm. They work in the material realm. They work in the financial realm. They work in the intellectual realm. No matter the field of endeavor, these principles of success are universal. And if we learn it, we can apply them to every area of our life and make a success of those areas of our life. All these people, historian, administrator, politician, academic, engineer, doctor, lawyer, pastor, housewife, they all need these principles in order to excel in their field of labor. So it doesn't matter. Somebody is a nurse. Well, that's good. Somebody is a teacher. Well, that's good. These principles are universal. Whoever you are, you can take them, apply to your field, and be your best. And I'm praying that tonight we'll be able to learn these essential ingredients for success and apply them in every area of our life and come out the best in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The first thing that we're looking at is burning desire to succeed. How hungry are you for success? How thirsty are you for accomplishment? That's what we are talking about. Success does not come delivered on a platter of gold. Success is not conferred, irrespective of our attitude towards it. Some people say, well, by and by, I believe I will succeed. You won't, because success doesn't come that way. Success doesn't come, to the person that doesn't seek it. Success is not like that. You must have a burning desire for success. Success must be desired. Success must be pursued for it to happen. You cannot be passive about it and experience success. It doesn't happen. You must pursue it. You must do something about it. That's important. The desire must not just be a comatose desire, a lukewarm desire. It must be a burning desire, a passionate desire, hot boiling desire. You desire it more than anything. That's what we call burning desire. What do we mean? Number one, God expects your desire to be good. The desire of the drug baron to make money is not good. Making money is good, but the way you want to make the money must be right. Making money by pushing drug is bad. That's a bad desire. So look at what the Bible says in I mean, Proverbs chapter 11, verse 23. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 23. So we need to establish that when we're talking about success, I'm talking about your desire is good. You want to make money by being a top professional. That's a good desire. Proverbs 11, verse 23. The Bible says, the desire of the righteous is only good, but the expectation of the wicked is wrath. The desire of the righteous is only good. Look at chapter 10, verse 24. It says, the fear of the wicked, it shall come upon him, but the desire of the righteous shall be granted. Do you know, as you read the Bible, that's also part of the principles of success. If we have time to talk about memory improvement and co, there's what we call the principle of association. You can improve your memory a lot by using the principle of association. You associate one thing with another thing and they stick together. It's like there is a peg and you use that peg to hang a hanger. The hanger will stay there because there is a peg. You associate them together, one hooks the other and keeps it in place. So the principle of association, what do I mean? Do you see the first passage I've just read to you? Proverbs chapter 11, verse 23. Now, let's do some maths. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 23. Remove 1 from 11. What do you get? Answer me. If you remove 1 from 11, what do you get?
10.
Add that 1 to 23. What do you have?
24.
So did you see that one? Proverbs 11, 23. Proverbs 10, 24. You can remember the two of them. Just know that once you remember Proverbs 11, 23, if I remove 1 from here, 10, and I add the 1 to here, 24. And both of them, they are speaking about desire. So it's easy to remember because you associate those two passages together and they are both Proverbs. So it's easy to remember them. This talks about desire, this talks about desire. What do we mean? You know, if you look at John chapter 21, I'm talking a little bit now. John chapter 21, verses 15 to 17, Jesus was asking Peter, do you love me more than this? Do you love me more than fish? He said, you know I love you. And Peter, he had to say it three times. But if you take just John 21, verses 15 to 17, but do you know if you take 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 to 17, he's talking about the same. Love not the world, neither the things of the world. If anybody loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. John 21, 15 to 17. 1 John chapter 2, take the one after the two, put it in front of John. 1 John chapter 2, 15 to 17, talking about the same. And there are many, many things like that. You know, sometimes some of us are just cramming Bible. It's not about cramming. Many times it's about association. Before I go forward, let me show you another association. In Psalms. Open to it. Psalm 35. Open with me, please. Psalm 35. Okay. Look at, let's first of all read Psalm 37, verse 25. I'm looking at Job. Psalm 37, verse 25. See what that passage says. Psalm 27, verse 25. It says, I have been young, and now am I old. I'm old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. That's chapter 37, verse 25. Do you realize that if you reverse the 5 and the 7, Psalm 37, verse 25, if you reverse the 5 and the 7, then you have Psalm 35, verse 27. Let's look at Psalm 35, verse 27. Psalm 35, verse 27. It says, let them shout for joy and be glad that favor my, that favor my righteous cause. Yay! Let them say continually, let the Lord be magnified, which hath pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. 37 says, I've never seen the righteous forsaken. He's always cared for. God prospers his people. Here he's saying the same. 37, 25, 35, 27. Just reversing the two, you know, the two numbers at the end. 37, 25, reverse it. Then you have 35, 27. So every time you remember one, you remember the other. It's called principle of association in improving your memory. It's part of the principles of success. We've not been able to talk about memory improvement and things like that. Maybe the time will come, we can be able to do that. But there are little things we can do that enhance success, even in the mastery of your Bible. You remember much more by using those principles rather than cramming, cram one and cram the other and cram the other and cram the other, and many times we forget them. No, I pray the Lord himself will help us in Jesus' name. Mm-hmm. And somebody says, well, Pastor, how did you discover this? Hey, burning desire to remember scriptures. And I'm looking at what are the methods I can easily use to remember scriptures. And I delve into memory improvement. And I read books in memory improvement, books like, you know, by Larry Lorraine and some other authors like that, and see practical things that I can utilize. Desire is all about desire. You want to get to the top. You want to be the best. How am I going to get there? Burning desire to succeed. And that's the first thing that we need to do. Here the Bible says, the desire of the righteous is only good. Let your desire be good. And if that desire is good, the Bible says, the desire of the righteous shall be granted. But I'm asking myself, does the righteous actually have desire? There are many believers, they just live their life, they eat semo today, and then they sleep. Tomorrow they wake up, another semo, and then they sleep. And they say, well, by and by, God will prosper me. No desire, no drive, no passion. They're not moving. And they're wondering why they're not making progress. It doesn't happen. The desire of the righteous shall be granted. Do you have a desire? Do you remember what Jesus said? Who of you intending to build a tower? Do you have an intention? Do you have a goal? Do you have what you are pursuing? Where do you want to get to? There must be a desire. The desire of the righteous is good, and that desire shall be granted. And when the desire is a burning desire, that desire will surely be granted. Those who have a burning desire, look at Matthew chapter 5. Let's see what desire is all about. The Bible uses other terms to describe it, but it's all about desire. Matthew chapter 5, verse 6. Matthew chapter 5, this is the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus said, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. What will happen to them?
Or they shall be filled.
Or they shall be filled. Hunger is a desire. A desire for food. And show me somebody is hungry for food when he gets into the house. Sometimes he's so hungry, he goes to the kitchen, he doesn't find food. He will look for food under the bed. When last did we keep food under the bed? But the guy is so hungry, he can't find food in the pantry, and he's thinking, well, maybe they put some curry on, I mean, under the bed. Let me go and check. He'll be checking for food under the bed. He's so hungry. It's a desire and must be fulfilled. Show me somebody who is thirsty. You give him something else, he's not interested. He wants water. And until he drinks water, he's not satisfied. It's a desire, strong desire, thirst, hunger. And the Bible says, the people that hunger for righteousness, they will be filled. The people that thirst for righteousness, they will be filled. That is a desire. That is a desire. Look at John chapter 6, verse 35. John chapter 6. That's another way. A burning desire for righteousness. Oh, you'll be righteous. A burning desire to be sanctified. Oh, eventually you will arrive. You will be sanctified. You will be sanctified. John chapter 6, verse 35. Jesus said, and Jesus said unto them, I'm the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. When you have an hunger, just like the Bible says, the desire of the righteous shall be granted. The thirst will be quenched. The hunger will be taken away. If you are hungry after righteousness, you will be filled. Jesus said, if you are hungry and you come to me, you will not hunger anymore. That will feed you. If you are thirsty and you come to me, I will make sure that you don't thirst anymore. You'll be filled. Burning desire always have a way of getting fulfilled, of getting accomplished. And in every area of life, we need to have that, a burning desire to make your marriage work. You've been hearing stories that men always beat their wives. The wife will bite the husband, fighting and quarreling in the family every time. If you have a burning desire to have a good family, you will have a good family. I had a burning desire to have a good family, that all the stories I'm hearing outside will never be replicated in my life and in my marriage. And it has never. Burning desire. He says the desire of the righteous shall be granted. God has guaranteed it. That if you have a burning desire, he will make a way for you to make sure that that desire is fulfilled. That desire is granted. Thirst for righteousness, passionate hunger. He says you'll be filled. Passionate thirst, deep thirst. He says you'll be filled. So it's important. This is a kind of desire, burning desire. And this is in the area of the Christian life. Why is it that so many believers are not righteous? They are rising and falling every time. They don't have a passionate desire, a burning desire to live a victorious life. Show me a believer that has a burning desire to live a victorious life. God will make a way for him. Grace will be available for him. God will make sure that that desire is granted. Show me a believer that wants to understand the Bible and he says, God, every time I pick the Bible, I want insight. I want you to show me, the working principles of God and things like that. I'm telling you, you will see a believer that every time, fresh insight, every time, fresh understanding, every time, fresh knowledge. That desire, God will grant it.
Amen.
So anything we are doing in life, I want to ask you, how burning is your desire? How passionate is your desire? How deep is your hunger? How deep is your thirst? Thirst for the things that matter in your life. Because they that hunger after righteousness, they will be filled. It's not that they might, they will be filled. And they that thirst after righteousness, the thirst will be quenched. And Christ said, if you come to me, you are hungry, you will never hunger anymore. If you are thirsty, you will never thirst anymore, because I will make sure that I quench that thirst. And that's what God is telling us tonight. If you are here on the platform and you just live life normal, it's not good enough. It's not good enough. It's not good enough. You need to have a passion, a desire. Where do you want to be? And how hungry are you to be there? Where do you want God to take you to? And how hungry are you? The people that work miracles, you take people like A.A. Allen, you take people like Shampak and Co. Go and read their biographies. You will see their burning desire to work miracles. They are ready to pray. They are ready to fast. They are ready to seek God. They are ready to read Bible to see how miracles actually happen. And eventually, you see miracles happening in their life. Burning desire to be a successful evangelist, ministering healing, and people will be healed right instant. Burning desire, and that burning desire will be fulfilled. That's what is lacking in many, many lives. No burning desire about anything. And that's why our lives many times are just flat. Nothing exciting, nothing dynamic, nothing great. It's because there are no desires. Because the Bible says, where desire is fulfilled, it's a well of life. It brings life. It brings dynamism. And I'm asking you tonight, what is your desire? Look at Psalm 85 in verse 6. This is somebody that is thirsty. This is somebody that is passionate. And look at what he said. Psalm 85, verse 6. Will thou not revive us again that thy people may rejoice in thee? Oh, let me tell you, somebody that is thirsty and hungry for revival like this, God will not leave him unrevived. He will experience that revival. He will experience that joy. He said, oh God, we are looking around for you. We have been praying. We have been seeking you. Oh God, will you not revive your people that your people may rejoice in you again? We experienced it before, but we want to experience it now. This is a thirst, a burning desire for revival, a hunger for revival. And this kind of people, God will make sure that this person, he experiences that revival. In Psalm 42, verses 1 and 2, some people don't understand what I want to read to you, because we quote it a lot, but people don't understand it. But let me show you. Psalm 42, verses 1 and 2. We quote it a lot. Psalm 42, verse 1. As the heart pants after the water brooks, so panted my soul after thee, O God. My soul thirsted for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before you? This is somebody who is burning desire for God, thirst for God. But the first part is what I want to tell you. As the heart panted after the water brooks, so panted my soul after thee, O God. Many believers quote that passage, but they don't understand it. Let me give you a background to this, to the story, to that verse. You know, the antelope is going in the bush, and then a tiger or a lion spots the antelope and starts running after the antelope. Sometimes the antelope will get into the bush, and the lion will look and look and look. The lion cannot find the antelope because the antelope has eaten. But the antelope, the lion can smell. So with the smell, we'll know the direction and we follow. And once it, the antelope will run again. But the antelope knows that the tiger can move faster. The lion can run faster. These are cats. The antelope has no. If the distance is long, eventually they will catch up on it. And the antelope is panting after water. You know what? Because when the antelope gets into the water brooks, what it does is the antelope will just go into the water, and the water will just kill straight away. And the antelope will go under the water and just swim like that. All the smell will disappear. The tiger comes, the lion comes, try to smell. There is no smell anymore. It escapes. So the antelope is saying, my only solution is to find water. My only solution, any water brook, I just jump into it, I will escape. And he's panting after the water brooks to be able to escape that. Oh, that's a deep desire. And we quote it, as the heart panted after the water brooks, so panted my soul after you. It's the only thing that will help it to escape that danger. And it's about burning desire, a kind of a hunger for that thing, panting after that. And that's a desire. And that's what God is telling us we need to manifest as well. Those who have a burning desire to experience revival, they are never denied the divine visitation. God will always meet them at their point of need. Burning desire, what can we liken it to? Deep hunger. Burning desire, what can we liken it to? A deep thirst. Burning desire, what can we liken it to? Passionate panting after. That's burning desire. This is a foundation for success in any endeavor. To the person that has a burning desire for success, failure is not an option. If he fails, he rises up. If he fails, he doesn't give up, because failure is not an option. He has a burning desire to succeed and nothing can stop him. And that's what we are talking about tonight. Let me ask you, do you have a burning desire to succeed? Do you have a burning desire to succeed? You know, I had a classmate. What I'm talking about tonight, I learned so much from my classmates. Burning desire to succeed. When we were in Form 1, this particular classmate of mine, he didn't know maths. And he was such a crooked boy, he used to cheat. So he would sit beside somebody who knows maths and he would cheat. And he knows how to cheat that the teacher will not catch him. That's how we went from Form 1 to Form 2. Then from Form 2 to Form 3, he did the same. Then when we got to Form 3, he made up his mind. I'm not going to cheat anymore. These people don't have two heads. I will know maths like they know maths. We were making jest of him, you. But do you know what? He tried. He studied on his own. He did everything. Going from Form 3 to Form 4, he never cheated. He did it by himself. He got 51%. Then when we got to Form 4, he said he was going to do additional maths. Everybody busted into laughter. Is it because of the 51% you got in maths, just barely managing to pass? You now said you want to do additional maths. Oh, but he said, I'm going to do additional maths. And we're looking. I was a body student. He was a day student. To know his burning desire, you know what he did? School normally starts at 8:10 and we finish at 2:10. When we finish at 10 past 2 p.m., we will go into the boarding house. I remember this, my colleague. When he's coming from home, he will take bread. It is in bag. So when we go to the hostel to go and have our lunch and then have siesta, he will bring out his bread. He will eat it and sit in the class. He's a day student. And then we will eat lunch. We will go for siesta. Then when we come for 5 p.m. prep in the class, he's there working maths. Then when we finish the 5 to 7 p.m. prep, and we are going to the boarding house to go and do our devotion, to go and, you know, eat our supper and later come back for our own evening prep. That's when he will be going home. Every day, from 2:10 p.m. when we finish until 7 p.m., he will be there 5 hours working maths. What a desire, working maths. In fact, he got to a point that he will give us some maths and say, you take this maths. If you solve it, I'll give you some money. And he would mention the money. We are not able to solve that. He became better in math than us. By the time we finished secondary school, this my colleague had A1 in maths, A1 in additional maths. He was the best in the school. I had A1 in maths, but I had A2 in additional maths. He was better than all of us. This was somebody that was far below us. He used to cheat. But burning desire, he transformed him. He took him to the top. And that's what I learned it in secondary school. I saw it. It happened in my eyes. So it's not that somebody told me the story. He's my mate. I still remember his name. I still remember his surname. Up till now, we went to the same university. Eventually, burning desire. If you have a burning desire for anything in life, you can be it. You can get there. You can get there. Failure is not an option. You don't give up. You just keep on moving. And I'm praying that tonight, that within you, there will be born a burning desire that will never die in Jesus' name.
Amen.
A desire that will push you and move you and motivate you and take you to the place of accomplishment in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Then the next thing we are learning is you must bust doubt and self-sabotage. Far too many people have failed as a result of self-doubt and self-sabotage. They have no confidence in their abilities, as well as no confidence in their environment to empower them for accomplishment. Their self-defeating question is always, can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? That was the question of Nathaniel when they told him, we have found the Messiah, of whom Moses in the law spoke. And then he said, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Yes, Jesus Christ came out of Nazareth, the Savior of the world. He came out of Nazareth, the Messiah. Came out of the Nazareth, the promised prophet came out of Nazareth. You know, some people, they say, this environment, what can it do for me? They don't even have any confidence in their environment to empower them for achievement. And their question is, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Sometimes they look at themselves and say, everybody can be succeeding but me. I don't think. Anything I put my hand on, I don't see it coming to anything, and it will never come to anything. It's self-doubt, it's self-sabotage, and that is going to hinder you every time. Do you know that's why even some ladies don't get married? Say me, look at my, they look at themselves in the mirror, say, look at me, look at all my face, pimples. Who will marry this one? And nobody will ever marry you. You don't, my sister. Forget about the pimples. Forget about the something. Oh, when God covers you with his glory and the tongue, the person that wants to marry you doesn't even see the pimples. Sees the grace of God upon your life. Sees the beauty that comes from heaven, not the physical beauty. And before you know it, you have suitors. Self-doubt. Self-doubt. Self-sabotage. We need to eliminate that out of our lives. Have confidence in your ability. God has endowed you. God has empowered you. God has equipped you. All the things you need to succeed. You know what God did? When you were being born, God packaged everything and put it within you. The abilities you need, the talents you need, the favor that will come over your life to make you succeed. God packaged everything and put it inside you. If you are not succeeding, it's because you don't even believe in those abilities. You don't believe in those, you know, in those connections. You don't believe in all those talents and innate abilities that God has given unto you that to get you to where God wants you to get to. Self-doubt and self-sabotage. Why is Messi and Ronaldo better strikers than most people? Oh, Messi and Ronaldo just believe that if I get on the field, I must score. They have so much confidence in their ability that no matter how good the, you know, the people that are marking me, I can beat them and I will score. And in most games, they score. They score. They just have confidence in their ability that no matter how good you are, I will beat you, I will beat the goalkeeper, I will score. And they will score. Score one, score two, and they are the top strikers in the world. They have so much confidence in their ability, and we need to do the same. Have confidence in your ability. Have confidence in your environment to empower you for accomplishment. You know, people are in Africa. They don't believe that Africa can produce anything until they get to the West. And that's why everybody, 1 year, 2 years, we're looking for visa. Looking for visa, looking for visa, 5 years. All the 5 years is wasted. The environment where he is can empower him. Where he says, no, I don't believe this environment can empower me. And he will spend 5 years looking for visa. By the time he gets the visa, time has gone. Why? Why? Wherever environment God that you find yourself, it's not by accident. There are things you can gain from that environment that can empower you to get to where you are going to go. When I was sent to Italy, the advantages in Italy are not, I mean, the advantages in England, they are not in Italy. Oh, but I don't look at the advantages in England and come and use my eyes to see the same advantages in Italy. No, I analyze the system. And I see other things in Italy that you cannot find in England. And I use that one. God has placed me here. There are things here that can empower me for success that may not be in the UK. I look for that. But I don't compare, you know, a country with another country. Your environment can empower you, but you need to have confidence in that environment, confidence in your abilities, confidence in your talents. So One of the things, essential ingredients for success, is to bust doubt and self-sabotage. You know, I see that one every time as a teacher. Sometimes I give them math question, and the student will take that math question, he will solve it, and he will do it right. Every step is good. Every step is right. Even the answer is right. And you know what? Because the student does not have confidence in his ability, he will cross it. And then he will re-answer the question, and all the things will be wrong. And then you'll be wondering and say, but why did you do that? What you did the first time and you crossed, it was right. The student has no confidence in his ability. He's doubting himself. Even when he has done it right, he will think it's wrong. He will cancel it and go and do it the wrong way. And such students, they never make A because they are not confident in their abilities. I pray that if you are in that category tonight, doubt will be busted in your life.
Amen.
Self-sabotage will be eliminated in your life.
Amen.
If you have been saying, can any good thing come out of this, my Nazareth? By the grace of God, something great is coming out of that Nazareth.
Amen.
Something great is coming out of that life.
Amen.
Something great is coming out of your environment.
Amen.
Something great is coming out of your career.
Amen.
And the Lord will empower you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Very important. Don't let self doubt. Let me give you a story. That's where I'm talking about self-confidence. When I was doing my PhD, I did my literature research, and then I picked a topic. It's going to be a lot of maths. I cracked the maths, and then I brought out what I was going to do. And then I presented it to my supervisor. I was so glad. But my supervisor looked at it, and then he pointed, you know, here, the assumption you made, so he poked holes in it. And that was okay. Then I went and I looked at it again. And then I solved the problem. I closed out all those loopholes. And I was sure this time that, yes, I was right. And I gave it to my supervisor again. And he looked at it, he said, it's not right. I said, it is right. He said, I said, it is not right. I said, it is right. And he looked at me. An African boy, he is a white, you know, professor. What do you mean? It is not right. I said, sir, I've done my homework. I'm sure it is right. You are arguing with your professor. Of course you can. Confidence in your ability. He told me to get out of his office. Because I think that no student has ever challenged him like that before. And I got out of the office. I went to the lab. Then he came to the lab. After some time, he saw me, I was playing. And he said, you are playing. I told you what you did is not right. I said, sir, what I did is right. Look at it again. I don't have anything to do, so I've got to play until... He looked at me and said, it's like this African boy, what is wrong with this guy? I was coming to the lab, you know, playing every day. After 2 weeks, he called me and he said, you know what? I've looked over that thing over and over and over. You are right. Wow. Brethren, that was my PhD thesis. That was my PhD thesis. Ah, but if I didn't have confidence in my ability, that's how he crushed it down. Yes, you might be a black boy and he is a professor. He doesn't have two heads. Have confidence in your ability to analyze, confidence in your ability, in your analytic ability. You've looked at it and if you are right, you are right. He may be a professor, he may not see it. And many people don't understand that. I'll give you another story. Somebody did a PhD physics, and then professors looked at that PhD thesis, they looked and looked and looked. They didn't see head, they didn't see tail. In that PhD thesis. So Albert Einstein was passing through France, through Paris. So they called him and said, Albert Einstein, this PhD thesis, help us to look at it. Albert Einstein at that time, he had already won the Nobel Prize. Albert Einstein looked at the PhD thesis, and Albert Einstein said, I can't see any value in this PhD thesis. But Albert Einstein said, but this guy may be smarter than all of us. So we can't see what he is seeing. So Albert Einstein said, give him his PhD, let him go. Because if tomorrow he is right, we will look stupid. So they gave that guy his PhD, not because they are convinced that what he did was right. Albert Einstein said, please give him his PhD, give him his PhD with his thesis. Because if tomorrow he is right, we will look stupid. That we looked at the work and we couldn't see it. And do you know what? That was the, you know, the particle light duality. You know, up till today, in particle physics, is one of the most fundamental things there. But they didn't give that guy the PhD thesis because they understood it. They said, but Albert Einstein said, this guy may be ahead of us. That what he's seeing, we are not seeing. Even me, I'm not seeing it. But it doesn't mean it's not right. And that guy was so confident in what he was doing. He was sure. You know, that's what many ideas have been killed. Many innovations have been busted because the people that are bringing it out, they are not confident in their own abilities. Any little thing that people say about it, they fall flat. When the Sambalat comes and says, even this wall you are building, even if a little rat goes on top of it, it will collapse. Then you get deflated. You are not confident in the work you are doing. Say, no, I've done a solid work. Even let an elephant climb, it will sustain the elephant. Because of jesting, that's how many people will give up the project. Say, well, look at how they are making jest of me. It means that thing cannot be anything. Have confidence. Confidence in your ability. Confidence in your ability to succeed. Confidence in your ability to accomplish. Confidence in your ability to bring that innovation. Confidence in your ability to be the best in the field in which you are. Confidence in your ability to get to the top and to succeed. Very, very important. It's an ingredient of success. So many of us, self-doubt has killed us. Self-sabotage has destroyed us, and we are not what God wants us to be. But tonight I'm praying that God will root out self-doubt from your life. God will root out self-sabotage from your life, that you'll be confident, the grace of God in your life, the anointing of God in your life, the talent that God has given unto you, the gifts, natural gifts, supernatural gifts that God has given unto you, they can empower you to succeed. Very, very important. You remember 12 spies were sent to go and spy the land. Then they divided themselves into two, 10 and 2. 10 of them said, we be not able to face these people. And 2 said, we are well able. They were in the same situation. They saw the same thing. They experienced the same. Why is it that 10 said we are not able and 2 said we are able? Confidence in their ability. Joshua said, if the Lord is with us, empowering us, these enemies, they are like bread for us. They don't matter. But those ones say, no, these are giants. We are like grasshoppers in their eyes. We are nothing to these people. Empowerment of God, do they believe in it? The talent and the gifts God has given them, do they believe in it? Why was it that David was able to face Goliath and Saul was not able? The same thing. Saul was a giant. David believed. Can you even see what David used in facing Goliath? A catapult and stones. Somebody coming with a shield, with a sword, with a spear, with an armor bearer, carrying. And David said, you come to me with a sword, with a shield, with a spear, but I come to you in the name of the Lord. David had confidence, and David said, look, the way I kill the lion, I will kill this Philistine. The way I kill the bear, I will kill this same Philistine. And Saul looked at him and said, okay, go. God be with you. He has never seen that kind of confidence before. David was confident in his ability. This catapult, I know how to use it. I used to kill the lion. This woman predator also, I will kill him with it. Confidence, confidence. But Saul couldn't. With all the endowment, he couldn't. Well, show me somebody who succeeds. It's because the person has confidence in his ability. And like I said, those kind of people, failure is not an option. Thank God for Henry Ford. You know Henry Ford? He is the father of the car engine. He made the first car. The first car that Henry Ford was trying to make, and he was a mechanic. Henry Ford never went to school. The total schooling that Henry Ford had was about 3 months in his life. He was practically an illiterate. 3 months of education, that's all. But he created the car. He had confidence in his ability, even as a mechanic, putting some things together. And then when he started testing his car, the noise was so much that, you know, it was creating deafening ears in the society, in the community. They took him to court. And the court had to ban him, never to start that engine again. But Ford will never give up. Show me somebody with a burning desire. Show me somebody that has confidence in abilities that something can work. He doesn't give up. Failure is not an option. You know what Ford did? Ford took that invention, that machine. He would take it into the wilderness very far so that when he started, if he's making noise, animals will be hearing, men will be spared. That's how he did it. But you and me today, we enjoy riding in a car. We enjoy riding in a bus. Thank God that for somebody that will never give up, they took him to court and the court banned him never to start that engine again. He took it to where it will not disturb anybody in the bush to be starting it and continue his experiment. But the world is a beneficiary. Everywhere in the world today, where don't you drive car? Where don't you drive truck? Where don't you have a lot of buses? But because of that invention, they don't give up. They have confidence in their ability. My brother, I'm asking you tonight, do you have confidence in your ability? My sister, I'm asking you tonight, do you have confidence in your ability? If you don't have confidence in your ability, success is going to be very difficult. If you don't have confidence in the empowering nature of your environment to help you to succeed, success will be very, very, far from you. Tonight, busting doubt and self-sabotage is one of the ingredients of success. Don't tell we are not able. No, we are well able. The task may look impossible, but it can be done. The task may look hard and very difficult and challenging, but we can face it. We can tackle the challenge. We must bust doubt and self-sabotage. Negative confession and profession, they are always self-fulfilling prophecies. You know what? It was Henry Ford, that same Henry Ford. He said, if you think you can, you can. If you think you can't, you are probably right. What he says is that the way you think will eventually determine your outcome. If you think you can, you will be able. If you think you can't, you won't be able. It's confidence in yourself, in your God-given abilities, in your God-given endowment. Now, there's a world of difference between humility and self-denigration. Humility is God has empowered you, God has endowed you, you are so skilled, but you are not boasting around, you are not, throwing your weight around, you are not oppressing other people because you are better than them, you are humble. It's different from, I know, I'm never good, and I don't know anything. Even if I do anything, it never succeeds. That's self-denigration. There is a difference between humility and self-denigration. Somebody can be a genius and be humble. He's not using it, he's not throwing his weight around to use it to oppress other people. He's just grateful that God has endowed him and is using it to add value to human lives. That's humility. Nothing happens when we feel powerless and useless, when we have no confidence in our God-given ability and talents. when we have no faith in the empowerment coming from God. Let me show you this. Isaiah chapter 41. Let me show you this. When you see people who have self-doubt, this is part of their problem. Isaiah 41. Let me show you. Isaiah 41. Let me read to you from verse 10. Isaiah chapter 1, verse 10. Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. My brother, what else is somebody looking for? This is God's guarantee. He said he will help you. He said he will sustain you. He will hold, you know, he will uphold thee with the right hand of his righteousness. He's telling you, don't fear, don't be dismayed. What else do you need? Do you have confidence in God's power to enable you? But look at in verse 13. God said again, for I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not, I will help thee. And yet, look at verse 14. Fear not, thou worm Jacob. That's how Jacob saw himself, a worm. And do you know one of the characteristics of a worm? Vulnerability. Worms are one of the most vulnerable animals in the world. If it's going, a hen can just come, chung, 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 just eat it up, and that's the end. If it's going, a little child can come, just put the feet, you know, on top of it, and just rub it like that, the worm is dead. Somebody can come and just put salt on it, and it will just shrink to death. Very powerless, very vulnerable. And Jacob said, oh God, do you see this worm? God is saying, I will help you. He's still seeing himself as worm. God says, I will strengthen you. He's still seeing himself as worm. God says, I will uphold you with the right hand of my righteousness. He's still seeing himself as worm. God says, I will take your right hand. I will take your right hand and lead you to where you are going. He's still seeing himself as a worm. And then God says, all right, you see yourself as a worm. Fear not, thou worm Jacob. I pray that I'm not seeing a worm there tonight.
Amen.
I pray I'm not seeing a worm on the platform tonight.
Amen.
Your God is saying he will help you, will strengthen you, will hold your hand. He says, I'm your God. Don't fear. Don't be dismayed. What else do you need? You have an empowering God helping you. Why are you calling yourself a worm? Oh, the Bible says that when God strengthens you, you will mount up with wings like the eagles. You will run, you will not be weary. You will walk, you will not faint. And that God says, I'm your God, I will help you. Then why are you calling yourself a worm? Self-denigration. Why are you calling yourself a worm? No confidence in your ability. No confidence in God to empower you. No confidence in your environment to help you, to empower you, to give you the resources you need to succeed. Then how are you going to succeed? How are you going to succeed? You already self-sabotaging yourself. So verse 14, fear not, thou worm Jacob, and ye men of Israel, I will help thee, say the Lord, and thy Redeemer, the only one of Israel. Say, if you don't know my name, I'm your Redeemer. If you don't know my name, I'm the only one of Israel. If you don't know my name, I'm your God. I will help you. If you not believe that, then pastor encourages you. The encouragement will go to waste. Because if God is saying, I will help you, and you don't believe God, is it the words of a man, the encouragement of a man that you're going to believe? Of course you will not. God is saying, I will strengthen you. I will uphold you with the hand of my righteousness. You don't believe it. Then when a pastor comes and says, well, God is going to do it, how are you going to believe it? Tonight, we need to burst self-doubt. Burst this self-sabotage. It's not pride to have confidence in the ability God has given you. Even spiritually, the gifts God has given you. Did you see Peter by the gate of the temple? Silver and gold I don't have, but such as I have, I give unto you. He was so sure and confident of the spiritual empowerment in his life. Say, such as I have, I give unto you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. You know, evangelists are very confident in the spiritual gifts that God has given them. That's why miracles happen. They are so confident. They just know that if I pray, something must happen. And when he prays, something must happen. God will back it up. The desire of the righteous shall be granted. God will empower him. God says, if you lay hands on the sick, they will recover. He will lay hands on the sick. He's so confident the sick will recover. They will recover. It's the promise of God. Confidence. Confidence. But even spiritually, many of us don't have that confidence. We don't. That's why things are not happening. You know, this happened several years ago. At that time, I was even about maybe 26. And my uncle was a manager at the Nigerian Arab Bank. He had been working in Central Bank before. Then when he retired from, you know, working in the Nigerian Central Bank, he joined Nigerian Arab Bank and they made him a manager in the Foreign Affairs Department. And he was dealing with foreign currency. But you know, these allergies will come, they want to do dubious business. He will not do dubious business with anybody. So the directors that were on top of him, they were frustrated. They were not getting the bribe they ought to get. They were not, you know, everything. But he was righteous and forthright. But you know, people wanted to do things. He didn't give in, no bribe, nothing. He just does his work. So eventually, there was this director on top of him. That director didn't like him. So one day, he came from office and I saw that Uncle was very sad. And then I said, Uncle, but you look sad today. What happened? He just gave me the letter. I took the letter and I read the letter. The letter said, by the end of the month, he's already sacked. So by the end of the month, he should pack his load. And he looked at it. And I said, Uncle, do you believe God? He said, yes. All right, let's pray. He wanted to kneel down. I said, no, you don't need to kneel down. He's more than 40 years older than me. Oh, at that time, he was about maybe 66. He said, no, you don't need to kneel down. You don't need. Just stand up. Today is more than 80. And then I prayed for him. And I said, God, like the letter was lifted during the time of Shenakeli. And the king said, oh God, you can lead. Look at all this nonsense that this person has written to blaspheme your name. Oh God, rise up and do something. And I commanded, I said, oh God, this letter, we notify it. This letter, we completely destroy it. Whatever they've said here, nothing will happen. In Jesus' name we pray. I was young and I believed it and I told Uncle, go, cheer up. Tomorrow go to work. Nothing will happen. And Uncle was looking, how is it going to happen? How is it going to happen? You know what happened? Within that month, something happened. That director that gave him the letter of sack, that director himself, he was sacked. He was relieved. And the letter he wrote became nothing. My uncle worked in Nigerian Naira Bank until he retired by himself. But I was so confident. I've read it in the Bible. I've seen it. You know, it's important for you. I was young, but that one doesn't matter. Confidence in God's ability to help you in time of need. He said, I will help you. I will strengthen you. I will uphold you with the right hand of my righteousness. I will take your right hand. I will lead you in the way. What else do you need? Have confidence in those promises. They will work for you. Self-sabotage. We need to get rid of it. That was the problem of this individual. Look at even Isaiah chapter 40. He didn't start in chapter 41. No. He started in chapter 40, in verse 26. Chapter 40, verse 26. It says, lift up your eyes on high and behold, who created these things that bringeth out their host by number. He called them all by names, by the greatness of his might. For that he is strong in power, not one faileth. Why sayest thou, O Jacob, and speakest, O Israel, my way is hid from the Lord, and my judgment is passed over from my God? Hast thou not known? God ought to be arguing with him. How can you be saying this? God doesn't see my situation. God doesn't even know what I'm passing through. And God said, how can you say this? What can be hidden from me? I'm the one that did this. I'm the one that did this. I told you I'm going to help you. That's the problem. Self-doubt. Even when God is putting everything in place to help him, he doesn't believe. He doesn't believe. That's the problem. Chapter 41, God is still saying, I will help you. I will sustain you. I will support you. I will uphold you with the right hand of my righteousness. I will hold your right hand so that you know that where you are going, I'm just by your side. Still, he called himself warm. I'm vulnerable. I can't do well. Nothing is going to work. And for that kind of a person, nothing will work. Nothing will work. Because nothing will work. Things will just be difficult. Say, didn't I say it? It's a self-fulfilling prophecy. You believe it wouldn't work, it wouldn't work. If you think you can, you can. If you think you can't, you are probably right. So we must bust that in our lives and make sure that all those things are gone. Self-doubt causes us to surrender our lives to the winds of adversity. I pray you will not surrender your life to the winds of adversity. Things are difficult, but you can overcome. The winds of adversity can come. It's not the end of the story. Maybe you have some setbacks. The setbacks are temporary. You don't have to make them permanent defeat. They are temporary setbacks. You can rise up and you can move. Don't surrender your life to the winds of adversity. Don't surrender your life to the wind of circumstances. When we have self-doubt, it causes us to never put up a fight, but to give up and to give in. Why do people give up and commit suicide? They don't think that anything can come out of their Nazareth, any good can come out of their Nazareth. When you read in 1 Samuel chapter 11, Nahash the Ammonite came and told the people of Jabesh Gilead, I want to remove your right eye. I want everybody to line up. I will remove your right eye, put it on the floor. Next one, remove his right eye, put it on the floor. And I will make a heap, a stinking heap. And I will use it, you know, as a kind of a shame on Israel. And they started crying. They were not ready. Then they said, okay, give us 7 days. Let's look for if people can help us. If people cannot help us, we will come out, we'll remove the eye and put it on the floor. You give up. You give in. You don't put up a fight. Oh, my sister, tonight, fight for your accomplishment. Fight for your achievement. Fight the good fight of faith. My brother, tonight, don't give up to the devil. Don't give in to circumstances. Don't give up on your dreams. Fight for your dreams, because truly, those dreams can come true, and they will come true in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So when we have self-doubt and self-sabotage, it will make you to give up. It will make you to give in. It will make you to give up the fight. You don't fight for anything. You just allow life to just push you anywhere. No, we are not going to allow the winds of adversity to just blow us here and there. No, we are not going to sail by every wind. We are going to be in control and sail the way we want to sail. Very, very important. Very, very important. You know, God has taught your hands to war. Look at Psalm 144. God has equipped you, my sister. God has equipped you, my brother. What are you doing without endowment? What are you doing without equipment? Psalm 144 in verse 1. See what the Bible says. Psalm 144, verse 1. It says, blessed be the Lord thy strength, which teacheth my hands to war and my fingers to fight. God has taught your hands to war. Go out and war. God has taught your fingers to fight. Have confidence in that empowerment. Go out and fight. Have confidence. The things God has taught you, the gifts God has put within you, the talents God has deposited in your life, the insights God has given unto you, utilize them to move forward. Utilize them to achieve. Utilize them to accomplish. Utilize them to get to the top. God has taught your hands to war and your fingers to fight. Have confidence in your God-given abilities. Go out and fight. Fight for your dream. Fight for your right. Fight to achieve. Fight to accomplish. Drive yourself. Very important. Let's bust all this self-doubt. A lack of confidence. God has given many, many, many. What God has deposited in our lives, most of us are living below our potential, below our capacity, because we don't have confidence in what God has given us. We're thinking, if I perform and I didn't perform well, people will make jest of me. So what? That's their business. Let them make jest. It doesn't matter. Go to where God wants you to get to. Don't be bothered about failure. You know, that brings me to the last point. You must build determination and steadfastness in your life. That's how you succeed. Because achieving success is a tough task. And the road to success is never smooth. It's always rough. Not just rough, very rough. There will be roadblocks that we must dismantle. You must summon the courage to dismantle those roadblocks. The way is not going to be smooth. No, the road to success is always very rough. The task is always very tough and challenging. That's why you need to determine. You need to build determination into your life. You need to build steadfastness into your life that you will not give up no matter what. There will be setbacks. That one is not a cause. It's normal. There will be setbacks that can cause those who are faint-hearted to give up. We must build determination within us to pursue success, to work for as hard as we ought to and as long as we need to achieve success. You know, many times we celebrate great companies. I remember when the founder of Motorola was retiring around 1961. The final speech he gave to the workers is that you will experience failure, but keep moving on. Oh, he knew it because Motorola got busted. Motorola, it collapsed. And eventually, the assets of Motorola, they were put for auction. And this guy did not even have a lot of money. So he went out to go and compete to buy back his company. He didn't even have money to buy it back, even at the rock bottom price at which the company was being auctioned. He bought the battery eliminator part. He bought it back with the small money that he had. That is what is Motorola today. He didn't give up because his company collapsed. He rose up from the ashes. The Honda that you know today, Honda went bust. Honda started all over. The Honda of today rose from the ashes of bankruptcy. You know, there is the man that started frozen food, who invented frozen food, his name is Clarence Botseye. When he was doing his experiment and he was investing money, the business was going on, he came to a point, the business collapsed. And Clarence Botseye, he had to borrow $7 from somebody, $7 to start all over. And then he borrowed a part of somebody's freezer to continue his experiment. After his business collapsed, but do you know what? 5 years from that, he sold the business for $250 million. That's what I'm talking about. They never give up. They build determination. You are building a business, building a business, building, and then everything collapses. Then you start all over. You start all over by borrowing $7. You don't even have any money. Borrow $7 from somebody. Borrow part of a person's freezer to continue your experiment. And from that point, 5 years later, he sold the company for $250 million. Oh, show me people who succeed. They are so determined. They are so steadfast. They never give up. If they fall 7 times, they are going to rise 7 times. That's how we succeed. Those are essential ingredients for success. You must develop the will to win. Never giving up. Never quitting. Quitters never win. Winners never quit. Develop the capacity and the will to win. You develop the decisiveness to be determined against all the odds. The attitude of persistence and perseverance in the face of failure and disappointment. You remember that woman with the issue of blood? She made up her mind. Whatever it takes, this healing, I must get it. Spend money, I will spend money. Spend time, I will spend time. Put in effort, I will put in effort. Chase, I mean, miracle people or doctors, I will chase them all around. This healing, I will get it. 12 long years. Eventually, the day came, she met Jesus. She didn't go. You know what we said? Blessed are those, the desire of the righteous shall be granted. Burning desire. Confidence that what you are chasing, you can get it. Eventually, you will get it. You remember the Syrophoenician woman? The woman was not bothered. Insult, doesn't matter. It's not right to give children's bread to dogs. Call me dog, that doesn't matter. What I want is what I want. I'm not sent to you, I'm sent to the Lordship of the house of Israel. Racism in the house of God, it's not bothered. Whether you are sent to me or you are not sent to me, that healing, I must assess it. And she did. The will to win, never giving up, against all odds, is going to break through. Whatever it is, no matter the difficulty, is going to surmount that difficulty. That's what it means to succeed. We must develop that positivity and determination that we are well able, despite the giants, we are well able, despite the chariots of iron. You remember the case of Caleb? Caleb was so confident about his abilities. In Joshua chapter 14, Caleb came to Joshua and said, Joshua, myself and you, we were part of the 12 that were sent to go and spy the land when we came to Kadesh Barnea. Now, 45 years have gone. 40 years old was I when I was sent. And 45 years have now gone since that time. I'm now 85. But you know what Caleb said? He said, I am as strong today to go out as I was when I was 40. Give me this mountain. I will conquer it. At 85, he was confident about his ability. Confident about God helping him. Confident about subduing the giants. At 85, he had not lost that confidence. He said, I am able to go out today as I was when I was 40. I'm 85, but I'm still as strong as that time. I still believe as I believe at that time. I can still conquer like I was conquering at that time. Give me this mountain. And do you know one of the most difficult places, Hebron, inhabited by terrible giants? That was what Caleb was given. He went, conquered the giants, inherited the land, gave to his daughter, gave to members of his family, confidence in his ability. I'm praying that tonight you will have confidence in your ability. Steadfastness, never giving up, moving and saying, you know, you remember the people of Gideon. The Bible says they were faint yet pursuing. Faint yet pursuing. He said, give them bread so that they can give this one, lazy ones, bread. He didn't give them bread. He went. He went to another place. Give us some provisions. Have you won the battle? I should give you provisions. Go. Gideon said, we will win the battle, but I will come back. I will teach you a lesson you will never forget. Faint yet pursuing. Those are people that They are not giving up. Tired, but he's running. Faint, he's pursuing. Already, things are difficult, but he's moving. He never gives up. You must build determination. You must build steadfastness in your life. You know, the Bible says, rejoice not against me, O my enemy. When I fall, I shall rise. That's important. When you fall, you are rising. You don't allow anybody. You don't give up. When I rise, when I fall, I shall rise. When I sit in darkness, the Lord will be a light unto me. The Bible says, the righteous falleth 7 times and they riseth. Oh, if you fall, rise. You fall again, rise. You fall again, rise. Because you are getting to that destination. Amen. You are getting to that destiny.
Amen.
Whether the devil likes it or not, the destiny that God has got for you, you will get there in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And you will get there in style. But the people that get there are the people that never give up. They're the people that are determined. They're the people that are steadfast. You know, I like a particular proverb in my language. It's a Yoruba proverb. Very good. It says that if you pounded yam on a leaf, if you cook stew or soup inside the pot of, you know, of groundnut, you see the pot of groundnut, how big is it? He says, but if you pound yam on a leaf and you cook stew in the pot of a groundnut, the people that will eat and be satisfied, they will eat and be satisfied. Other people will say, but what are we going to do? What are these among so many? What are we going to do with this? But other people, even in the midst of that lack, they will be satisfied. Those are the people that never give up. Those are the people that are determined to succeed at all costs. You say there are no resources. Resources will surface. Those are the people that say, I'm going to cut off Goliath. Say, where is your sword? He said, don't worry, the sword will manifest. They are determined to do it. Even in the midst of lack of resources, they are saying, this project will be accomplished. Say, but where is the resources coming from? You don't worry. This project will be completed. That determination, that steadfastness, resources will come. The project will be accomplished. It will do things. We must build that determination into our lives. Into our lives. Maybe you are there. You are doing your master's. You've had a lot of challenges. Some course modules have flawed you. My sister, rise up. You must pass that course module and you must finish that master's. You are bagging your master's and going home with it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You will not come to Europe with the hope of having a master's and return back to Africa or whatever without it. The Lord will empower you. The Lord will help you. The Lord will uphold you. The Lord will give you insight. The Lord will bring resources around you to make sure that that project is completed and accomplished in Jesus' name. But you must determine. You must determine. You must be steadfast. You are not giving up. You are saying, God, by your power, I'm going to achieve. I'm going to accomplish. Building determination and steadfastness into your life. Very, very important. These are the things that we need to do. These are essential ingredients for success. Let me remind you, the three tonight. Number one, burning desire to succeed. How deep is your hunger? How deep is your thirst? How are you panting after? Are you panting like the heart pants after the water brooks? And nothing else matters to the heart. It's just in search of the water brooks. Nothing else matters to you. You are just in search. You are panting after that success. How burning is your desire? How passionate about success are you? How hungry for success are you? How thirsty for accomplishment are you? That will determine whether you succeed or not. Then you need to bust doubt and self-sabotage. My brother, God has empowered you. God has endowed you with so many skills, with so many talents, natural talents, supernatural gifts. God has given it unto you. His power is with you. His grace is with you. His insight will enable you. His knowledge is by your side. Why are you going to fail? You will not fail. You will succeed in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Have confidence in that ability that God has deposited in you. Have confidence in your environment to empower you. You know, this platform, for example, is part of the environment God has put there to empower you. But we will say, if I come to Thursday Revival Hour, what is that one going to do? I said, I'm having trouble. Oh, you don't have confidence in the words we are speaking on this platform, the encouragement and the insights we are giving in this platform to empower you to the place of accomplishment that you want to accomplish. Have confidence in your environment to empower you to succeed. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Yes. Jesus of Nazareth came out of Nazareth. He was the Messiah, the Savior of the world. He came out of Nazareth. Yes. Something good can come out of Nazareth. Maybe you look at your life. Can anything good come out of this Nazareth? I prophesy over your life tonight. Something good will come out of that Nazareth.
Amen.
Something
Amen.
That will add value to your environment. Amen. Something that will add value to your generation.
Amen.
Something that even you yourself, you will live and say, even me. Yes, even you. Because God has deposited so much in you, and you will use it to accomplish in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And then build determination and steadfastness. Don't let anything make you to give up. Don't let anything make you to give up. There are many people that have tried and tried and tried and tried and tried before they succeed. It took quite a long time. But it doesn't matter. They succeed anyhow. And they succeed massively in the process. Somebody asked a man that was massively successful and said, tell me the secrets of your success. Tell me how to succeed. The man looked at him and said, double your failure rate. Secret of success, double your failure rate. What he said is that the more you fail, you are gaining wisdom, you are gaining insight. And that wisdom that you are accumulating in trying this project, you fail. Tomorrow you know what works and what doesn't work. You try this project and that doesn't work. You know what works and what doesn't work. It will come to a point. You have accumulated so much wisdom from those failures. When you hit a project, it will be a mega success. That's what he's saying. That double your failure rate. The more you fail, the faster you can succeed, because you are going to gain a lot of wisdom, a lot of insight from those setbacks that eventually, when you come to the right project and the right idea, you hit it big, make a success. But it takes determination. You never quit. You just keep on going. You just keep on going. And I pray that none of us will quit.
Amen.
The determination to keep on going, God will give unto us.
Amen.
And you'll be like Paul that said, forgetting the failures of the past, forgetting the successes of the past, I reach forward unto the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. You are always moving forward. You learn from the success, you learn from the failure, but you are moving forward because better things are ahead. You are reaching forth to the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. That's how to succeed, my brethren. That's how to succeed, my brethren. And I pray that God will help you to succeed in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's rise up and pray and tell the Lord essential ingredients for success that God is going to help you. If you don't have a burning desire, you need to create it. You need to create it. Passion for success. Passion for accomplishment. Passion to get to the top. You need to create it. And God himself, he will help you. Essential ingredients for success. Burning desire to succeed. You have a burning desire to be your best, burning desire to get to the top, burning desire to contribute, to add value to people, burning desire to inspire, burning desire to be the top in your profession, burning desire to be your best, burning desire to make your marriage an example to everybody around you, burning desire to be a successful minister, burning desire. How hot is your desire? How burning is your desire? How thirsty are you for accomplishment? How hungry are you for achievement? Are you panting after success like the ant pants after the water brooks? Burning desire to succeed. That's what you need. That's what you need. And if you have it, oh, God has already promised and guaranteed that the desire of the righteous shall be granted. If that burning desire is there, God will make a way for that burning desire to be fulfilled. It will. And every form of self-doubt, you need to cast it out. Have confidence in your God-given abilities. Have confidence in the supernatural deposit of gifts that God has given into your life. Have confidence in the natural endowments that God has put into your life. Have confidence. Have confidence in your environment to empower you. Have confidence in God to empower you to succeed. Don't be discouraged. Don't every time look at the negative side of things. No, be encouraged. I am well able. I am well able. I am well able. Like Caleb and Joshua, we are well able. That should be your attitude. Positive attitude.
I am conquering those mountains.
Expectation of the best every time. And build determination. Build steadfastness. Rise up every time defeat stares you in the face. Rise up. Every time there is a setback, rise up and overcome that setback. You are moving on your way to success. You are moving on your way to accomplishment. Rise up and keep moving. Maybe you have faced disappointment in your career. My sister, rise up and keep moving because success is ahead. Success is ahead. God will bring you helper. God will send you favor. God will open a door for you. God will create a way for you in the wilderness. God will make rivers for you in the desert. But you need to keep on moving. Be determined and steadfast. Never quit. Don't give in. Don't give up. Don't give up the fight. Fight for your dream. Fight for your goals. Fight for accomplishment. Keep on moving. Keep on believing.
Nothing will stop me from moving forward.
Even when you are faint, keep on pursuing. Refuse to quit. Keep on pursuing. Success is ahead. Your rising is bright. The sun will rise again. Keep on moving. Keep on moving. Keep on moving. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for tonight, for this essential qualities and ingredients of success you have shared with us. You have told us that succeeding, we need burning desire, deep hunger, a deep thirst, a panting after. You have already guaranteed that if we have desire, the desire of the righteous shall be granted. But we have to generate that desire. We have to have that desire. Then you will make a way for us in the wilderness. You create rivers for us in the desert. You make a way for us for the fulfillment of our desires and our dreams. Oh God, I pray for those who are just too relaxed about life, no passionate desire. I'm praying tonight, let there be a spark in their spirit. Okay. Let there be a fire in their bones. Yeah. Let something dynamic start to happen in their life. Hunger for accomplishment, desire for success, a burning desire, love for righteousness, burning desire for revival, to be their best, to live in victory, to live in dominion, that failure is not an option. Rising and falling is not an option. Every time they want to be on the mountaintop, oh Lord, I pray that this burning desire will be the portion of everyone on the platform tonight in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And Lord, we are shooting ourselves in the leg because we are not confident about the abilities you have given us, natural abilities. We are not confident about the supernatural gifts you have imparted into our life. And we are not functioning at the maximum of our potential. Oh Lord, I'm praying that every form of self-doubt, every form of self-sabotage, we will put them aside. We will rise up and like Caleb, we are well able. Even though we are meeting giants, we are well able. Even though we don't have much and there are chariots, we are well able. Even though Goliath is coming against us with a spear and with a shield and we only have catapult and a stone, we are well able. Oh Lord, confidence in our God-given ability, confidence in the ability, in God to empower us, to help us to succeed. Confidence in our environment to empower us and to create, you know, a conditions to prosper for us. Oh Lord, grant us that in Jesus' name.
Amen.
That we will not be like, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Oh, even if our life is Nazareth, something good is coming out of our Nazareth. Amen. Jesus Christ, the Savior, is coming out of our Nazareth.
Amen.
The Savior of the world is coming out of our Nazareth.
Amen.
The great physician is coming out of our Nazareth.
Amen.
That promised Messiah and prophet is coming out of our Nazareth. Yeah. Everything that the enemy has belittled in our life and says, this one, it can never amount to anything, it will amount to something.
Amen.
Something
Amen.
Good will come out of it.
Amen.
Something Amen. Good will come out of your career.
Amen.
Something good will come out of your research.
Amen.
Maybe even your supervisor says, this research, I don't see anything here. I'm telling you, my brother, something good will come out of that research in Jesus' name.
Amen.
We must have confidence in our God-given abilities and in our environment and in God to empower us to achieve. And Lord, we are praying. Success does not come without setbacks. Success does not come without temporary difficulties, temporary defeats, temporary setbacks. But the people that succeed are the people that never turn the temporary setback into permanent defeat. They keep on moving. They fall, they rise up. They fall, they rise up. The righteous man falleth seven times and he riseth again. Oh Lord, I pray that none of my brethren, they will never quit. Your grace will be sufficient for them, that even though they are fainting, they will yet pursue. Even though things are difficult, they will keep on moving. Amen. They keep on keeping on. Oh Lord, empower them. We know that quitters never win, and winners never quit. Oh God, grant them the will to win, that they will never quit. Amen. The determination and the steadfastness to keep on pursuing until they get to their destiny, grant unto them in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank
Amen.
You, Lord, because we know you've answered. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray.
Amen.
Amen.